Breakfast with Buddha, a novel by Roland Merullo, narrated by Sean Runnette. Copyright 2007 by Roland Merullo. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with Algonquin Books, a division of Workman Publishing, and was produced in the year 2011 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright there too. Humor is a prelude to faith, and laughter is the beginning of prayer. Reinhold Niebuhr. Like the lark that soars in the air, first singing, then silent, content with the last sweetness that satiates it, such seemed to me that image, the imprint of the eternal pleasure. Dante, Paradiso. Genuine belief seems to have left us. Walt Whitman, Democratic Vistas. I hear America singing, the varied carols I hear. Walt Whitman, I Hear America Singing. Chapter 1. My name is Otto Ringling. No circus jokes, please. And I have a strange story to tell. At first look, it may appear to be the story of a road trip I made at the suggestion of my wonderful wife from our home in the suburbs of New York City to the territory of my youth, Stark County, North Dakota. In fact, it is the account of an interior voyage, the kind of excursion that's hard to talk about without sounding foolish or annoyingly serene, or like someone who thinks the Great Spirit has singled him out to be the mouthpiece of ultimate truth. If you knew me, you'd know that I am none of the above. I think of myself as Mr. Ordinary, good husband, good father, average looking, average height, middle of the road politics, upper part of the American middle class. Friends think I'm funny, sometimes a little on the wise-ass side, a decent, thoughtful 40-something man who has never been particularly religious in the usual sense of that word. My story here will strike them as out of character, but there's nothing I can do about that. I promised myself I would just tell the truth about my road trip and let those who hear the story embrace it or mock it according to their own convictions. So in the spirit of full disclosure, let me say this. Before the drive to North Dakota, like a lot of people I know, I suffered now and again from a nagging puzzlement about the deeper meaning of things. I functioned well, as the saying goes. My wife and children and I had a comfortable life, really a superbly satisfying life. Nice house, two cars, restaurant meals, love, peace, mutual support. And yet from time to time a gust of uneasiness would blow through the back rooms of my mind, as if a window had been left open there and a storm had come through, and my neatly stacked pages of notes on being human had blown off the desk. By the time I returned to New York, that wind had gone quiet. Outwardly, nothing had changed. I did not start practicing levitation. I did not shave my head and undertake radical dietary adventures. I did not quit my job and move the family to a restored monastery in the Sicilian countryside or leave Jeannie and the kids and shack up with a 22-year-old editorial assistant from the office. Inwardly, however, in those back rooms, in the deeper recesses of thought and mood, something felt entirely different. And so, even though I am a private man, I made the decision, again at Jeannie's suggestion, to write down what had happened during my days on the American road. If nothing else, I thought the story might drop a few laughs into someone's life, which is not a bad thing these days. So let me begin here. I am an ordinary, sane, American man, 44 years young, senior editor at a respected Manhattan publishing house, Stanley and Burns, that specializes in books on food. I've been married to the same woman for almost half my life. We have two teenage children. Natasha is 16 and a half, Anthony 14, an affectionate mixed-breed dog named Jasper, and a house in one of the pricier New York suburbs. Jeannie works very part-time as a freelance museum photographer and very full-time as an attentive mother. It's not a perfect life, needless to say. We've had our share of worry and disappointment, illness and hurt, and with two teenagers in the house, we sometimes experience a degree of domestic turbulence that sounds to my ear like a boiling tea kettle filled with hormones shrieking on a stove. But it is a life Jeannie and I made from scratch, without a lot of money at first or a lot of help, and we are proud of it and grateful. 6 months before my trip, a sour new ingredient was dropped into the stew of that good life, into the swirl of dinner parties, arguments over homework, and two-week rentals at the shore in August. My parents, Ronald and Matilda, 72 and 70, were killed in a car crash on a two-lane North Dakota highway called State Route 22. In full possession of their mental faculties, in excellent health, they were familiar voices on the end of the phone line one day, and unavailable the next. Gone. Silent. Untouchable. Hardy farm people with forceful and distinct personalities who were turned to ash and memories by a drunk just my age in a careening blue pickup. We all went out to North Dakota for the memorial service. My sister, Cecilia, who lives in New Jersey, took the train. She inherited my mother's fear of air travel. Tears were shed. There was talk of the old times, good and not so good. There was anger at the man, soon to be imprisoned, who had killed them. I expected all that. What I did not expect was the enormous feeling of emptiness that surrounded me in the weeks following my parents' burial. It was more than bereavement. It was a kind of sawing dissatisfaction that cut back and forth against the fibers of who I believed myself to be. Sometimes, even in the sunniest moods, I'd be aware of it. Turn your eyes away from the good life for just a second, and there it was. Not depression, as much as an ugly little doubt about everything you had ever done. Not confusion, exactly, but a kind of lingering question. What's the point of all this? Would be putting the question too crudely, but it was something along those lines. All this striving and aggravation, all these joys and miseries, all this busyness, all this stuff. 1,000 headlines, 100,000 conversations, emails, meetings, tax returns, warranties, bills, privacy notices, ads for Viagra, calls for donations, election cycles, war in the news every day, trips to the dump with empty wine bottles, fillings and physicals, braces and recitals, Jeannie's moods, my moods, the kids' moods, soccer tournaments, plumber's bills, sitcom characters, oil changes, wakes, weddings, watering the flower beds. All of this, I started to ask myself, leads exactly where? To a smashed-up Buick on a country highway? And then what? Paradise? All right, I'm a fan of the old idea that if you live a decent life, you rise up to heaven afterward. I'm not opposed. But sometimes, riding the commuter train home past the tenements of Harlem, or calling Natasha and Anthony away from their IMing long enough for the frenzied modern ritual of a family meal, or just standing around at a friend's 50th birthday party with a glass of Pinot Noir in one hand, I'd feel this sudden ache cutting along my skin, as if I were suffering from a kind of existential flu. Just a moment. Just a flash. But it would pierce the shiny shell of my life like a sword through a seam of armor. I'd had similar moments even before my parents' deaths. But after that day, February 7th, a frigid North Dakota Tuesday, it was as if a curtain had been lifted and the ordinary chores and pleasures of life were now set against a backdrop of wondering. The purpose, the plan, the deeper meaning. Who could I trust to tell me? A therapist? A local minister? A tennis partner who'd lived 10 years longer and seen more of the world? I found myself thinking about it at night before I went to sleep, and while standing on the train platform on my way to work, or watching TV, or talking with my kids, and even, sometimes, just after Jeannie and I had finished making love. And so I suppose such a state of mind left me perfectly primed for my extraordinary adventure. If I can risk a sweeping observation, it seems to me that life often works that way. You ask a certain question again and again, in a sincere fashion, and the answer appears. But in my experience, at least, that answer arrives according to its own mysterious celestial timing, and often in disguise. And it comes in a way you're not prepared for, or don't want, or can't, at first, accept. Chapter 2. When they retired from farming, my parents remained in the house where my sister and I had been raised, and they leased the 2,000 fertile acres surrounding it, land that was planted in sunflowers, soybeans, and durum wheat. After their deaths, the duty of selling off the old farmstead fell upon my shoulders, as I am the older and, I have to say this, only responsible child. It was not a job I wanted, God knows. There was more than enough on my plate without that helping of High Plains beef. But there are duties you don't turn your back on. Your child is hungry, you make dinner. Your spouse is ill, you take care of her. Your parents die, you settle the estate. Two things made this duty more complicated than it might otherwise have been. The first was my younger sister Cecilia, a nice enough woman who is as flaky as a good spanakopita crust, and who, as I mentioned, does not tolerate air travel well. And the second was the fact that, though I had zero interest in keeping the house and land, I did, for sentimental reasons, want to salvage a few pieces of my parents' sturdy antique furniture. So how best to sell the house and move the furniture, given my sister's unpredictability and the long distances involved, became, in my mind, the North Dakota question. Over the course of our marriage, Jeannie and I have developed a nice ritual. On Thursday evenings, no matter what else is going on, we sit together for an hour over a glass of wine, and we talk. These conversations range from Natasha's taste in boyfriends, outrageous hairstyles, enormous vocabularies, to the excesses of the president of Belarus. We laugh, we tease, we debate, and we sip good wine, out on our fieldstone patio in warm weather and at the kitchen table in cold. One of these conversations, it was April, the maple trees were in bud, we sat indoors, was devoted to the North Dakota question. "You're procrastinating on this," Jeannie said in her typically straightforward fashion. "Thanks. You've always had North Dakota issues. You've always avoided them." "It's not issues. It's a house. Land. It's 5 or 6 old oak tables and chairs and so on." "Issues. You sound like my sister." "Which is another issue. Your siblings are more or less normal. You can't relate. You grew up in Central Connecticut. No one has issues about Central Connecticut." Jeannie laughed. She has beautiful chestnut hair, just touched with a streak of gray now, and she has so far resisted the temptation to cut it short. We were in the kitchen and were drinking, I remember, a cold, fruity vernaccia. I reached across and refilled her glass. Above our heads, something that might have been called music thumped in Anthony's room. I glanced at my wife and saw that around the edges of the North Dakota question, a familiar kind of empathy and understanding floated. Aged love, time-tested. What could beat that? Jeannie twirled her glass. My parents' marriage had been solid but tumultuous, their relationship composed of weeks of tender mercies and a stoic, High Plains peace, interrupted by volcanic arguments over something as simple as the way my father put his toothbrush in the holder or how Mom cooked the oatmeal. I wondered if they'd been having one of these famous fights when the front bumper of the pickup smashed through Pop's door at 70 miles an hour. "You're going to have to drive out. You know that," Jeannie said at last. Cecilia has to be there, and she'll never fly, and you'll need to rent a trailer to cart the stuff back. Movers could do it. Movers can't sell the house. Real estate agents can. You should go and make your peace with the place. You know you should, Otto. And you need some time away from us and away from work. It's been years since you've had a real break. I could fly and meet her there. A frown. Then a shriek and door slamming somewhere above us. We waited a few beats to see if it was anything serious. No. And leave Cecilia to drive there and back, Jeannie said. Alone, in her 14-year-old Chevrolet, with her 20-year-old maps, she'd end up in Honduras. She could intuit her way, consult the spirit guides. The frown again. So much contained there in the flex of a few muscles. All of history, it sometimes seemed to me. All of ours, at least. She made it out for the service, okay, I said. Okay? Getting off the train in Fargo instead of Minot? And having to hire a car and driver with her last $100? You and I at the Amtrak station watching passengers get off, the train pull away, no aunt sees? That's your idea of okay. Reasonably okay, I said. And then, what about this? What about we make a family trip out of it? 2 weeks in August, just the four of us in the minivan. Aunt Cece takes the train. It was one of those offerings you know are dust before the last syllables are out. At work, on a fairly regular basis, I was on the receiving end of similarly frail proposals. The author of a book that sold 300 copies saying she had an idea for a new project, an exhaustive treatment of the Bulgarian sour pickle. She could make it work. She knew she could. Jeannie set down her glass and began to count on her fingers. 1. We trade Cape Cod for Greater Bismarck, which means sea breezes and 70s for tornado warnings and 96 in the shade. 2. Our dog and our two beautiful offspring sit in the back of the same car for 3,000 miles, round trip. 3. I held up my hand. You had me at 2. Look, let me at least run it by the kids. I have the vacation time. I could take 3 weeks instead of 2, one on the Cape, the rest for the Ringlings on the road. We could visit some chefs I know, historical sites. Have some first-class meals, make an adventure out of it. Jeannie looked at me for a three-count, a touch of amusement at the corners of her mouth. She said, I have 2 words for you, my love. And which 2 might they be? Not? Likely. And on that note, our 60 minutes of alone time ended. Chapter 3. During dinner, I decided not to go anywhere near the North Dakota question. Jeannie cooks, the kids set and clear the table and sweep the floor. I like to wash the dishes. Though we are fairly relaxed in our parenting style, we have 2 rules. Show basic respect for others at the table, and no books, magazines, schoolwork, or electronic devices while food is being consumed. Natasha and Anthony had apparently been arguing about something upstairs, and they passed the meal buried in slightly different versions of adolescent sulking. Natasha picking at her food, Anthony wolfing it. During cleanup, they muttered and snarled, then pounded off to their separate door slammings and various algebras. When the sink was clean, dishes stacked, I made my way up the stairs carrying my hopelessly optimistic family vacation plan in both hands like a pot of dying geraniums to a sick aunt. I knocked on Natasha's door and found our scholarly daughter at her computer, headphones on, the walls around her papered with soccer players from the U.S. women's team and posters of teen boy rock stars with flat stomachs and pouty lips. Still sour-faced from the argument with her brother, she took off the headphones and, somewhat reluctantly, turned to me. I pulled up a chair. I noticed for the 1,000th time how much she resembles my mother through the eyes. A High Plains gray-green, pioneer directness, as if beneath the freckles and long lashes lay windswept stone. At moments I worried that, Like my mother, she would make a steady, dependable, but not particularly warm wife. Then again, I'd come home 2 hours early one afternoon that winter and discovered her and her genius boyfriend, Jared, making out on the living room couch, and there had been plenty of warmth there. An abundance of warmth. I said, "Tasha, you know I have to go to North Dakota to settle Graham and Gramps' property." "I know, Dad." A glance at the computer screen. Maybe Stacy was writing to say that Neil's new hairstyle wasn't as cute as his old one, or that Eileen's choice in skirts that day had been off the wall. It was important to answer such things without delay. "Well, I thought it might be fun if we made a road trip out of it. The four of us. Jasper, too. We could try camping, or stay in nice hotels, or a combination. Swim, eat, see the big sights. A family adventure. What do you think?" She looked at me for what seemed the span of her childhood, then said, "Camping, Dad? With, like, my brother, the disgusting beast?" "Okay, so minus the camping out of the equation. What do you think of the idea?" The look in her eyes was suddenly the look of a 30-year-old. "It is a law of the universe that your words come back to you, and in exactly the same tone of voice." "Dad," she said, "be sensible." I am an upbeat sort of person in general. It's a valuable temperament in the book publishing world where there are 18 failures for every success, and where the tidal sweeps of fashion knock even the most sure-footed soul into the hard surf at least once or twice a year. It's a valuable temperament in the rough waters of raising teenagers, too, and so, though I'd gotten exactly nowhere with Natasha, I stepped down the hall and knocked on Anthony's door, thinking that if I could convince him to come out in favor of the family road trip, then he and Jeannie and I could gradually work Tasha free of her resistance. That spring, Anthony was going through the ordeal known as puberty. His nose and ears were growing too fast for the rest of his face. His skin was breaking out. Dark hairs were showing themselves above his top lip. His sister, of course, never tired of reminding him of these troubles, and Jeannie and I were often having to act as referee. When I went into his room, I found him lying on his bed, tossing a baseball into the air and catching it, over and over again, in a sullen hypnosis. "I remember doing that," I said, sitting sideways on the bed and squeezing his lower leg once. Anthony was at the age where he did not particularly like to be touched. Some nights I'd try to get to 1,000 catches. "On those boring North Dakota nights, huh, Dad?" He stopped tossing the ball and looked at me. "They could be pretty bad. But it's a cool place in other ways. You've never seen the real countryside there. Wild buffalo, the Badlands, Native American stuff. Yeah? It's like a different world," I went on, encouraged. "Graham and Gramps liked it there." I saw a familiar shadow come over his pimpled face. He and my father had been close. "Still sad about them, huh?" "Yeah. I have to go out there, you know, to settle the estate, sell the house." "When?" "August. I should drive, and August is the only time I can get away from work for that long. Want to go?"
"Where?"
"North Dakota."
"Driving?"
"Sure, I thought we'd make a family adventure out of it, all of us."
"Nah."
"What about just me and you, then?"
"Nah.
I was thinking of going out for football. I was going to ask if I could stay at Jonah's house when you guys go to the Cape." "You're 135 pounds, I wanted to say. But I didn't. I had been a 135-pound football player myself, seen a total of about 14 minutes playing time, and had a lot of good memories from those days. And one shaky knee. What if we made the trip before football? It starts August 3rd, Dad." "All right. But in principle, you'd like to go, right?"
"Not that much, to tell you the truth. I'm into, like, my own private space these days. You know, all that time in the car together, motel rooms. Not my thing." There is a patio at the back of our house. It's the usual setup: outdoor furniture, potted plants. Standing or sitting there, you can look down toward a stream that cuts its weak flow into a brush-filled ravine. It's all we have in the way of wildness. And some evenings, sitting in a patio chair facing those trees as darkness fell, I'd feel a fleeting sense of some other way of life. Less domesticated. Less safe. Not free of family obligations, exactly. I loved being part of a family, but with fewer of the responsibilities of modern American middle-class suburban life. Fewer of the particular concerns and duties that are payment for the safest, richest, easiest lifestyle in human history. That night, after the visits with Natasha and Anthony, I went out and stood on the patio and stared off into the trees. Our faithful dog, Jasper, came and leaned against my leg, a silent pal. Though Jasper was more affectionate these days than either of our two kids, I knew they loved me. I knew they'd swing out away from Jeannie and me over the next years, then come circling back. When they were in their 20s and 30s, we'd all be close. But by then, they'd have their own lists of concerns and duties, their own oil changes, doctor's appointments, and business meetings. Maybe their own kids. Very possibly their careers would pull them 1,000 or 2,000 miles away, leaving Jeannie and me to grow old the way my parents had, buoyed by a phone call once or twice a week, flowers on Mother's Day, hectic visits. Why were we all so proud of a style of living that splintered the family like so much dried-out firewood? I heard the screen door close and recognized the scrape and tap of Jeannie's shoes on stone. She came up beside me in the dark. Jasper moved over and leaned against her knee. "No go on Dakota?" she said. "No go. I've been out here pondering the meaning of life." "That bad, huh?" "Not so bad. They're good kids, just drifting out into their own orbits already. It's natural. It's right. Though I guess I have this image, I don't know, of some perfect, endless family life," she said. "All happiness and McDonald's commercials." "No McDonald's, but yeah, I guess so. Something that doesn't just dissolve in a burst of cell phones and grumpiness, then whoosh away into biannual visits. You're an idealist by nature, my love. I just go along taking what comes. What comes is pretty good. More than pretty good," she said. And then, "I've always thought work solved the idealist part for you. I mean, a beautiful photograph of a glistening lamb chop with purple new potatoes and asparagus. There's some imagined eternal perfection represented there. Something lasting. Your books are unmodeled." "Is that a word?" "It's the eternal part I'm thinking about, I guess." "Nothing we can do about that, honey." "I know, sure. But does that mean we have to just go along with everything? Live like everybody else lives, by the same assumptions?" "Is that the best we can do?" "It's your parents dying. You lost them, and now you're worried about losing the children, which won't happen. I just don't want to look back with regret, that's all. If there's any chance to look back. What do you have in mind? Go and live on a Greek isle?" "I don't know. At least the family would stay together longer if we lived on a Greek isle. Do things as a unit instead of flying off into iPods and emails and jobs on the other edge of the continent. You took a job 1,800 miles away from your parents. I know it. And I love our life, I do. I just question it sometimes lately on some level. I can't describe it. I've been feeling this way for a while now, even before my parents died. Midlife, maybe. I don't know." For a few minutes, we were quiet. Jasper trotted away on the scent of a porcupine or squirrel, more because he didn't like the conversation, didn't like hearing about death and abandonment. Couldn't imagine a life without Tasha or Anthony there to scratch him behind the ears as they lay on the couch in the TV room. Aside from the occasional skunk, there was no danger lurking for him in the darkness, nothing to fear. He hadn't known his parents or siblings, didn't have children, probably didn't worry about what would happen to his loved ones and to his soul after he died. Off in the distance, beyond our little stream, we could hear traffic on the Hutchinson River Parkway, a steady drone of tires and engines, even at this hour. Everyone going, I thought. Always going, always hurrying. But headed where? You know what you need? Jeannie asked after a while. What? To drive my loony sister to North Dakota and back? Yes. But before that, you need to retire early and go upstairs with your extremely affectionate wife. Chapter 4. Sometimes, after making love with Jeannie, I'd lie there beside her and feel as though the multifarious complexities that surrounded our life had been whisked away like particles of fog on a warm wind. Mind would be clear, body at peace. A fresh optimism would bloom along the windowsills of the bedroom, laying its frail, scented wreath across the sheets and pillows, and I would be clear-minded and capable, and what had to be done would be obvious, and my ability to do it beyond doubt. That, or something like it, is what happened on the night I've been describing here. Before the lovemaking, there was the sour taste of obligation postponed. There were the stunted conversations with the kids, two of the three people I love most on this earth. And there was the patio sadness yawning off toward a meaningless eternity. After the lovemaking, there was the calm understanding that the trip to North Dakota would be only 10 days, 2 weeks at most, that my odd sister was a good-hearted soul. Jeannie and the children would survive perfectly well without me. Little chance I'd enjoy the trip. Even post-coital calm doesn't turn a tree root into a truffle. But it seemed at least possible that by getting so far away from the ordinary routine, I might gain a new perspective on things. It was a wonderful feeling, really, that sleepy, sure state. I think sometimes that our national obsession with sex, and if you don't think there is a national obsession with sex, just browse the magazine racks in the local chain bookstore, is really nothing more than a profound spiritual longing in disguise. The desire to exhaust all other desires and feel loved and sated, at peace with our fragmented modern selves, linked to those around us. At peace, at rest. I wonder sometimes if the same deep desire lies at the heart of addiction to drugs, to drink, to eating, to work. Are we all just desperately looking for some strategy that will get us past the shoals of modern existence and safely into that imagined, calm port? But those strategies, injecting heroin, say, or spending 80 hours a week at the office, work for a time and then stop working. Eventually, the bill comes due. It occurred to me as I faded toward sleep that while I wasn't addicted to anything, well, good food perhaps, I had devised a strategy of my own, a weaving together of favorite pleasures, food, family time, sex, work I enjoyed, tennis, vacations, TV, reading. They made a harmless enough tapestry, a pretty landscape of pleasure speckled with moments of selflessness, annoyance, worry, fear. But it was a strategy, all the same, and it had started to wear thin. And then my parents dying had punched a hole in the worn section. That night I had the feeling there might be something on the other side, waiting to show itself to me. All through spring and half the summer I thought about that something, wondered, pondered, let the episodes of doubt wash over me and leave me slightly less steady on my feet. I knew I'd have to go to North Dakota, but all through May, June, and part of July, I was somehow able to pretend to myself that it would be a quick, easy, painless errand, just a tiny glitch in the predictable pattern that was my life. Chapter 5. In New York, over the course of the month of August, you go from the feeling that summer will never end to the feeling that it has. But before it ends, the publishing world slips into a kind of hibernation. The more successful editors, agents, and authors flee Manhattan for the Hamptons, the Vineyard, the Cape, the Berkshires, upstate. Skinny sons go out for football and come home starving, scratched up, elated. Daughters work the mall job and the babysitting job and are lulled to sleep at night by visions of their very own car. Suburban wives garden and chauffeur, shop and cook, and lie in the sun at the tennis club pool. And suburban husbands, of course, naturally, it goes without saying, pack up one of the family cars with a suitcase, maps, a couple of sport coats, and head off, where else? To the prairies of western North Dakota. It was an uneventful leave-taking. Just after breakfast, I knocked on Anthony's door and stepped into his own private space to say goodbye, only to find my son all but unconscious on the bed, face down on the sheets in nothing but a pair of blue Bronxville Broncos gym shorts. Natasha was away on a lucrative 4-day babysitting junket for friends of neighbors who had a house on Block Island and tow-headed boys who could shout, "Give it to me, now!" in 3 languages. And Jeannie was off making breakfast for a friend who'd had some kind of stomach surgery and could not yet cook or drive. We'd had a nice meal the night before, shiitake risotto and chocolate pudding, and said our goodbyes then. So I was set for the road. Still, I procrastinated just a bit, waved at my son's backbone, and said a silent farewell. Took my time going downstairs. The refrigerator hummed. A lemony morning light fell across the tablecloth, touching a vase of homegrown flowers there and the scattered pages of the Times. So thoroughly had the domestic life enveloped me over the past, 20 years, that I felt, once I'd at last closed the back door behind me and was striding toward the driveway, that I was peeling away several layers of skin and setting off into America's dusty center in my bare, raw flesh. But I went, out the driveway, right on Palmer, through the center of town, and then down Highway 87, past the Hall of Fame for Great Americans, along the Harlem River, and over the George Washington Bridge. I was headed toward the city of Paterson, New Jersey, where Spanakopita Cecilia lived. My sister, the odd duck. There was the excitement of the road. There was the sadness at leaving Jeannie and the kids and Jasper behind. There were the miles of crowded expressway. And then, as I took the main street exit, Paterson, making everyone welcome, the billboard said, and turned into a Latin stew of discount shops and grand old buildings, and went past the Greater Faith Church of the Abundance. A creeping dread worked its way up from the soles of my running shoes. Out of embarrassment, I've so far refrained from saying how my sister makes her living. Here's a hint. After working my way through downtown Paterson, I turned onto her street, and there, jutting out toward the road like a garish fingernail, was a lavender and cream sign. Cecilia Ringling, Tarot and Palm Readings, Past Life Regressions, Spiritual Journeyings. Journeyings, I thought. Journeyings was perfect. This lifestyle of hers had been a stone in my parents' sensible work shoes from the day Cecilia moved east and had business cards printed up. Their idea of journeyings was to drive to Minot in August for the ox pull at the state fair. Their idea of spiritual was a trip to the Lutheran church in Dickinson on Sunday mornings, where they would hum along with the hymns and endure the sermon, have a buffet lunch afterward at Jack's Cafe, then drive back to the farm and the real business of life. "You mean," my father said to my sister once when we were both visiting, "you mean to say you make a living telling people what they used to be 1,000 years ago? I pulled in just beyond the sign, then drove all the way to the end of the driveway so that the car would not be visible from the street. Foolish, of course, because the chances of anyone in Paterson recognizing my car or me were 1 in 100,000. Still, around the office, I have a certain reputation for being the no-nonsense Midwestern type, and it wouldn't do to be seen going in for a past life regression on my first day of vacation. Before getting out of the car, I sat still and took a few slow breaths. I told myself what I'd been telling myself all spring and most of the summer, ever since I'd picked up the phone and given my sister the big news that we would be driving to North Dakota together. I would be kind. I would be patient. I would rein in the side of me that wanted to mock and ridicule. I would indulge, to a fair degree, Cecilia's odd culinary habits. I would remember that she adored my children and that my children had adored her since the days when they could not yet properly pronounce her name. 10 days. Separate motel rooms. I would be kind. But when I got out of the car and turned toward the house, I saw that she was sitting on the edge of her shabby deck, barefoot, and that she was not alone. I felt myself flinch. Cecilia and her companion were not touching, but they were sitting in what seemed to me an intimate posture. I immediately girded myself, tried to keep a pleasant, open-minded expression on my face. My sister got the good looks in our family. I got the good sense. She has beautiful, wheat-colored hair, a large, happy mouth, and eyes, brown like Pop's, that give off a kind of shine you usually see only in the eyes of young children. There is a kind of structural perfection to her features, if that's the right way to put it, and it has always made me think of Michelangelo working with marble, and always made other men think of ways they might convince her to take off her clothes. For better or worse, the number of men, and perhaps a few women who knew, favored by that good fortune, is not a small number. Which is not a problem for me. I am the farthest thing from prudish, and in any case not one to throw such stones. Before I met and started dating Jeannie, I had my wild times. Let's leave it at that. The issue was not quantity, but quality. In high school, when she could have had a date with any boy in the sophomore, junior, or senior classes, her preference was the window-smashing, car-crashing, drug-loving son of the mayor. In college, it was a boyfriend old enough to have personal memories of the Civil War. After college, a motorcyclist with crossbones tattooed on his neck. Then, in this order, a yoga master who bilked the ashram and was chased back to Delhi in disgrace, a dreadlocked bicycle repairman poet with pet piranhas, a septuagenarian orchestra leader participating in the first studies of male enhancement medications and not shy about introducing that topic into dinnertime conversation at the Ringling home. It was, I often said to Jeannie, a serial menagerie of masculine misfits. And we met them all. They came for visits and stayed for a night or two, or five. They came for Thanksgiving and Christmas and 4th of July and Buddha's birthday. Jeannie cooked for them. The kids loved them, especially Jack or Jacques, the bicycle fixer, who gave them free tune-ups on their 10-speeds, riding crazily around the block in high-speed test runs, hands clasped behind his matted curls, legs pumping furiously as he sang Bob Marley's No Woman, No Cry. To each of them, I was unfailingly pleasant and welcoming. I should pause here for just a moment and say this. I enjoy the variety of humanity. I am not one of these people who wants everyone to live the way I live. What causes more trouble on our troubled earth than people like that? The homogenists, I call them. Look at me, they say. I'm happy. I'm right. I'm law-abiding, productive, and pleasing to God. All you have to do is live like I do, and we'll have world peace. And if you don't live like them, they'll slaughter you. I am the farthest thing from a homogenist. I love my life, but I'm not foolish enough to believe that everyone else would love it. Certainly not Cecilia. I just wanted some stable, long-term companion for her, someone the kids could call uncle, someone who wouldn't disappear one day, leaving behind his greasy wheel sprockets, list of methamphetamine customers, or broken viola strings. My parents had wanted the same thing for her, and it made me sad that they'd died without ever seeing it. As I walked towards Cecilia and her new beau, I began to think that this time she'd outdone herself, eclipsed her personal record for the most unusual lover. Because as my sister stood up, and then the man beside her stood up, I saw that he was wearing a dress, or what appeared to be a dress, a gown, perhaps, a robe. The robe was deep maroon with gold or saffron trim, and wrapped around him in a mysterious way so that it seemed to hold itself up by magic. My God, I thought, Aunt Cece is dating the Dalai Lama. But not really. The robe was messier, and there was something in this fellow's bearing that reminded me more of a long-haul truck driver than a peaceful monk. True, his head was shaved, but he wasn't smiling. He was 2 or 3 inches shorter than my sister and built like a middle linebacker, with a wide, rough face that could have belonged to a man of 35 or a man of 60. It was almost as if he were a combination of all his predecessors, part yoga master, part biker, with a glint in his eyes like that slimy orchestra guy. Cecilia swished toward me in her long hippie skirt and hugged me warmly, but too long, throwing a little back massage into the bargain. When we finally parted, she hooked me by one arm and half turned toward the World Wrestling Federation cross-dresser. "Otto," she sang, "this is my guru, Volya Rinpoche. Rinpoche, this is my darling brother." Rinpoche bowed slowly, then brought a thick, calloused paw out from beneath his skirts and gave me a crushing handshake. Cecilia turned to me, cheeks aglow, and pronounced this memorable sentence. "Otto, sweetheart, Rinpoche is going on the trip to North Dakota." And I, of course, pretended not to hear. Chapter 6. I decided, as I sometimes do, I suppose I've learned this in business, I'm not particularly proud of the tactic, to delay. Though I had figured on losing only 10 days round trip to the North Dakota errand, and though with the packed car, full tank of gas, and a driving schedule all worked out in my mind, I had an itch to get on the road and put some miles behind us, I decided it couldn't hurt to linger for an hour or so at Cecilia's and see if she'd let logic prevail. This was a tactic I often used with her. She would come for a visit all excited about teaching Anthony to knit because such activities should not be, she said, gender-specific, or instructing me and Jeannie in the fine art of Wanapana meditation because she'd just taken it up and it had deepened all of her relationships, or training our half-Doberman Jasper to eat vegetarian because it would speed up the transit time of his digestion and help him live longer. And over the years, Jeannie and I had learned not to confront these initiatives head-on. Instead of getting into an argument, we'd slip Jasper a quarter pound of bacon just before his tofu treat mix, and so on. It was all harmless enough, and I'd figured out that while my sister was consistently wacky, her wackiness was inconsistent, her interests as fleeting as a bumblebee buzzing around your ears. Swat at the bee, and you risked a sting. Ignore it and let it do its buzzing, and soon it would be off to other pastures. So, though I'd heard perfectly clearly when she said Volya Rinpoche would ride with me, I was pretty certain it was just another of the well-intentioned but odd ideas that twirled inside Cecilia's gray matter for a few seconds or a few days at a time, then dissolved into the ether. "Show me your garden," I said, because that was always a safe subject and a sure distraction. With the bare-armed, maroon-robed Rinpoche floating along somewhere behind us, we strolled down to the sunniest section of my sister's pleasantly cluttered backyard and inspected her plot of vegetables. Cecilia is a world-class gardener, has been since my parents gave her dominion over a 20-foot square piece of tilled backyard when she was 6. Until the wildest of her teenage years set in, she'd practically wallpapered her room with ribbons from the Stark County 4-H competition. Tomatoes, potatoes, onions, lettuce, 4 kinds of squash, she seemed almost to will bushel baskets of vegetables from our black soil, undeterred by the scorching summer sun and brief growing season. "Magnificent," I said as we stepped single file along the rows of yellow peppers and cherry tomatoes, Swiss chard and baby eggplant. "This reminds me of when you were a girl. You always had a magic touch with gardens, Cece. You still do." I turned and saw how happy and proud she was, her beautiful face giving off a summery glow. She plucked two cherry tomatoes and handed one each to Rinpoche and me. "You don't have to wash them," she said. "They're completely organic." I expected nothing less. The tomato was like a grenade of flavor bursting against the teeth. "It's almost lunchtime. I could make us a nice salad. I have some good bread. Okay?" "Fine. Sure," I said. The bread would taste like compressed sawdust, but I consoled myself with the idea that we could stop for something soon after we got on the road. I love to eat. Love everything about food. The growing, the preparation, food photography, restaurant design, the history of the menu in various parts of the planet. And despite a regular exercise regimen, I have the modest bubble of a belly that testifies to my passion. One of the promises I'd made to myself about the trip was that I would indulge Cecilia's culinary quirks, but not at the expense of my own. There are lines one does not cross. She picked a handful of vegetables, lifted her skirt into a kind of bowl in front of her, and carried them into the house that way. For a moment, the man I thought of then as Volvo Rinpoche and I were face to face in a faint gust of patchouli. He was giving me a direct look from out of his rough face. "Nice tomato, huh?" I remarked. And he lifted his eyebrows and smiled widely, as if I'd said something very clever. It occurred to me, perhaps because he hadn't yet spoken a word, that his English might be weak. The house was messy, but in a welcoming way. Mismatched vintage furniture, some kind of Nepali or Indian tapestries on the walls, statues of deities from various traditions, crystals, candles, bird feathers, potted aloe plants. It felt more like our North Dakota farmhouse than my own suburban home ever did, and I experienced a twinge of memory about Mom and Pop. It occurred to me then, just the most fleeting of thoughts, that my return to North Dakota on this particular errand might not be such a simple matter after all. We sat in Cecilia's kitchen at her wonderful old white metal table with its chipped porcelain top. She served Rinpoche first and generally looked at and spoke to him as if she were the county chairwoman of the Catholic Daughters and he was the Pope. But we all had equal portions of an exquisitely fresh salad, mismatched mugs of iced green tea, and two slices of pressed sawdust. And to my great relief, there were no prayers said over the food, no hand-holding, no chants, no blessings of any kind. Rinpoche nodded and smiled a great deal, but said nothing. Cecilia asked about Anthony, Natasha, and Jeannie with so much genuine affection in her voice that I forgave her 3/4 of her oddities in the time it took to chew and swallow a bite of bread. "They wanted to come," I told her. "The kids wanted to see their Aunt Cece." For a minute there, I thought I could convince them to just load up the minivan and all of us make the trip together. As she listened to this small lie, a flicker of something not so good touched Cecilia's features. It was quick as a hummingbird kiss, just a momentary dimming of the smile. But of course I noticed. We were, after all, brother and sister. I had noticed, too, walking from back door to kitchen, that she did not have any suitcases stacked up on a chair ready to go into the trunk of my car. They could be in the bedroom, I told myself, but as we finished the meal, as Cecilia turned her back and took our empty salad bowls to the sink, I began to have a sense that an unwelcome surprise was floating in the air above the kitchen table. My own psychic abilities, heretofore undiscovered, were soon confirmed. Cecilia paused for a moment with her hands gripping the front edge of the sink, then turned and marched resolutely back to the table, maintaining eye contact with me the whole way. She sat down very deliberately. She said, "Otto, We have to have a conversation. I said, I noticed you haven't packed. She said, I'm not going. Not going? Since when? You have to go. I don't have to anything. Right. Good. I just took off 2 extra weeks from work, lost half my time at the Cape with my wife and kids, packed up, planned the whole trip. And why? Because you said you wanted to be there to say goodbye to the land, and because you are uncomfortable flying, and you wait until I get to your house to tell me you're not going. I could feel the Rinpoche next to me. In my peripheral vision, he seemed to be smiling. I had an urge to punch him, and this was a big deal because I had not punched anyone since a fine day 22 years earlier when Michael Redgwick put a hand on Jeannie's ass at a UND graduate student dance to which I had brought her. Something has changed, my sister said mysteriously. Right. Good. I appreciate it. Otto, she reached out and put her hand on my arm. I know you think I'm a nutcake. You're nice. You try to hide it. But I know you think that. Nutcake is as nutcake does, I said stupidly. It had been one of Mom's sayings when we were kids and eventually turned into a family joke. You couldn't have called me, at least, before I left home. You wouldn't have come. You're damn right, You wouldn't have met Rinpoche. I realize that, and I'm pleased to meet... Does he speak English? They both nodded. I turned to face the man. I'm pleased to meet you, really. You seem like a very pleasant man, but... I looked at my sister. Cecilia, what means more to me than meeting Rinpoche, nice as he is... You never would have come. You never in a million years would have agreed to go to Dakota with Rinpoche. I'm not. I haven't agreed. I'm not doing it. It's important that you do, Otto. I won't. I'm giving him my half of the land, and the house too, if you'll let me. Or you can take more of the land to make up for it. The land is worth some money, isn't it? I looked at her. I looked at Rinpoche. Every story I'd ever heard about soft-hearted single women preyed upon by con artists came honking around me like a gaggle of geese. I said, Rinpoche, would you mind leaving us to fight in private for a few minutes? Rinpoche smiled and nodded. A bit too vigorously, it seemed, almost as if he were somehow making fun of me. But he stood and went out the back door without complaint. When I heard the latch click, I said, Are you sleeping together? Otto, is he trying to con you? Con me? You are so off base that Mom and Pop's property, our property now, is 2,000 acres of prime North Dakota wheat land. Do you have any idea what that is worth? She shook her head. $500 an acre. She reached up and put the fingers of her left hand to her throat, a gesture straight out of her earliest years. You're kidding. $1,000,000. Our little farm in the middle of nowhere. Plus the house. I had no idea. Plus the mineral rights, which we'll retain, just in case.
Still want to give... We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.